readings for today's Mass will be found in the Breastplate on page 45. This Mass is being offered for the poor souls in purgatory. Our opening hymn is These 40 Days, number 481. Prior to beginning this Mass, let's take a moment and pray. Lord, show me one way in this Mass that I can become a better version of myself. Lord, as I listen to the music, readings, prayers of the Mass, a homily, and the quiet of my heart, what is one way you are inviting me to be a saint? Give me the grace to respond. Please stand.
Inward. feeds God.
Happy Lent.
Happy Lent, Father.
Thank you. Raise your hand if you've heard of some virus that people are afraid of. I have much to say about this topic this evening. I received an email yesterday from the Archdiocese that I opened this morning. It's a statement on behalf of the Archdiocese regarding implications of the transmission of pathogens at Mass and other liturgical celebrations such as the coronavirus COVID-19. So, I'm not going to read this to you, but I'm just going to tell you like what it says. It says that people are supposed to wash their hands. Raise your hand if you were taught by your mother to wash your hand. It says that if people are sick, they're not supposed to come to church. If you don't know that, let me be the first to tell you. Coming to church when you're sick is actually a terrible thing to do, because you're inflicting your sickness on other people.
So don't do that. If you're sick, it's not a sin to miss Mass. Now, there is a difference between being sick and being what I call sick when I was a young child and did not want to go to school. I hope we all know the difference between the two. One is called being sick, one is called faking it. If you're sick, don't come to Mass. Okay? Now, on to the practical things. We are to be now suspend the sign of peace at Mass. So at Mass, I will say, the peace of the Lord be with you. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
And then we'll go, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of... Now, I'm just going to say this. If you feel the need at that moment of Mass to touch someone, like, you can do it. I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. So if you feel the need to, like, turn to your spouse and, like, give them a hug or a kiss or, like, pat your kid on the head, whatever you need to do, like, that's you. Like, it's totally you. But we will not any longer, at this point, be touching each other during Mass, okay? Just so you know. It's totally your choice there. Also, it says, suspend holding hands during the Our Father or the Lord's Prayer. Well, first of all, we don't do that here at All Saints. You might, though, maybe you hold hands with your spouse or your child. You can continue to do that unless you think they have the coronavirus, then you should stop doing that. It says that we should refrain distribution of Holy Communion under the appearance of wine from the chalice. We already do that, so we don't have to worry about that. It also says discontinue the practice of touching all of the non-communicants and offering them the blessing. We don't do that either, which is just gross in general. Like, in my opinion, that I'm going to, like, touch someone's head and then distribute food afterwards, particularly the food which is on the altar. And then it also says refrain from using holy water fonts. So you'll notice when you walked in today, if you're trying to bless yourself, you were just blessing yourself with air, which is always a good thing to do, because we love the air and water and earth, so, like, it's really, really good. If you want to use, so this is a quick clarification, holy water is awesome, and the devil hates holy water. So in all of our campuses, there are places where you can get holy water. Or if you want to bring me gallons of holy water, like gallons of water, I will bless it and turn to holy water. And you can sprinkle holy water everywhere in the whole entire world, particularly in your homes and all of your children, particularly that need it, or your spouse maybe. But we aren't supposed to use common holy water dippers. So those are all the things that I was supposed to announce to you today about the coronavirus. Does everyone feel safe? Please don't touch the person to your left or to your right. They might have a coronavirus. You have no idea how much I love this. Okay, in honor of the coronavirus topic, I'd like to read a story that many of you are familiar with, but it has been going through my mind, and since I was, like, asked to do this weekend, I now think that this story is completely merited. It's a powerful, powerful story, a powerful image, and ever since this whole, like, coronavirus thing has been going on, this has been the image in my mind, and I just can't get it out. So I was like, if I'm going to make this announcement this weekend, I'm going to scrap the homily to say I did have a homily plan. But we're going to listen to this instead, because I think that it just fits, it's very fitting, and it's powerful. Okay? So here we go. This is from the prologue of Rediscovering Catholicism by Matthew Kelly. Imagine this. You're driving home from work next Monday, after a long day, you turn on the radio and you hear a brief report about a small village in India where some people have suddenly died. Strangely, of a flu that's never been seen before. It's not influenza, but four people are dead. So the Centers for Disease Control is sending some doctors to India to investigate. You don't think much about it. People die every day. But coming home from church the following Sunday, you hear another report on the radio. Not only now, it's not four people who have died, but 30,000 in the back hills of India. Whole villages have been wiped out, and
experts confirm this flu is a strain that they've never seen before. By the time you get about Monday morning, it's the lead story. The disease is spreading everywhere. It's not just India now. Now it's spread to Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran, Iraq, and Northern Africa. But it still seems far away. Before you know it, you're hearing the story everywhere. The media has now coined it the mystery flu. The President of the United States has announced that he and his family are praying for the victims in hoping that the situation will be resolved quickly. But everyone's wondering, how are we ever going to contain this? That's when the President of France makes an announcement that shocks all of Europe. He's closing the French borders. No one can enter the country. And that's why, that night, while you're watching a little bit of the evening news before you go to bed, your jaw hits your chest when a weeping woman's words are translated into English from a French news program. There's a man lying in a hospital in Paris dying of the mystery flu. It has come to Europe. Panic strikes. As best as they can tell, after contracting the disease, you have it for a week before you even know it, then you have 4 days of unbelievable symptoms, and then you die. The British close their borders, but it's too late. The disease breaks out in Southampton, Liverpool, and London, and on Tuesday morning, the President of the United States makes the following announcement. Due to a national security risk, all flights to and from the United States have been canceled. If your loved ones are overseas, I'm sorry, they cannot come home until we find a cure for this horrific disease. Within 4 days, America is plunged into an unbelievable fear. People are wondering, what if it comes to this country? Preachers on television are saying it's the scourge of God. Then on Tuesday night, you're at church for a Bible study when someone runs into the parking lot and yells, "Turn on the radio!" And while everyone listens to a small radio, the announcement is made. Two women are lying in a hospital in New York City dying of the mystery flu. It has come to America. Within hours, the disease envelops the country. People are working around the clock trying to find an antidote, but nothing's working. The disease breaks out in California, Oregon, Arizona, Florida, Massachusetts. It's as though it's just sweeping in from the borders. Then suddenly the news comes out. Code has been broken. A cure has been found. A vaccine can be made. But it's going to take the blood of somebody who has not yet been infected. So, you are asked to do just one thing. Go to the nearest hospital and have your blood tested. When you hear the sirens go off in your neighborhood, you are to make your way as quickly as possible to the nearest hospital. Sure enough, by the time you and your family go to the hospital, it's late Friday night. There are long lines of people and a constant rush of doctors and nurses taking blood and putting in platelets. Finally, it's your turn. You go first. Then your spouse and children follow. And once the doctors have taken your blood, they say to you, "Wait here in the parking lot for your name to be called." You stand around with your family and neighbors, scared, waiting, wondering. Wondering quietly to yourself, what on earth is going on? Is this the end of the world? How did this ever come to be? Nobody seems to have had their name called. The doctors just kept taking people's blood. But then suddenly a young man comes out running out of the hospital screaming. He's yelling a name and waving a clipboard. You don't hear him at first. What's he saying, someone asks? The young man screams the name again. He and a team of medical staff run in your direction, but again, you can't hear him. Then your son tugs on your jacket and says, "Daddy, that's me. That's my name they're calling." Before you know it, they've grabbed your boy. "Wait a minute, hold on," you say, running after them. "That's my son." "It's okay," they reply. "We think he has the right blood type. We just need to check one more time to make sure he doesn't have the disease." 5 tense minutes later, out come the doctors and nurses, crying hugging each other. Some of them are even laughing. It's the first time you've seen anybody laugh in over a week. An old doctor walks up to you and your spouse and says, "Thank you. Your son's blood is perfect. It's clean, it's pure. He doesn't have a disease. We can use it to make the vaccine." As the new news begins to spread across the parking lot, people scream and pray and laugh and cry. You can hear the crowd erupting in the background as the gray-haired doctor pulls you and your spouse aside and says, "I need to talk to you. We didn't realize that the donor would be a minor. We need to have your son make consent form." The doctor presents you with the form and you quickly begin to sign it, but then your eye catches something. The box for the number of pints of blood to be taken is empty. "How many pints?" you ask. Then the old doctor smiles, begins to fade, and he says, "We had no idea there'd be a child. We weren't prepared for this." You ask him again, "How many pints?" The old doctor looks away and says regretfully, "We're going to need all of it."
"I don't understand. What do you mean, all of it? He's a child. He's my only son."
The doctor grabs you by the shoulders, pulls you close, looks you straight in the eyes, and says, "We are talking about the whole world here. Do you not understand? The whole world. Please, sign the form. We must hurry."
"But can't you give her a transfusion?"
"If we had clean blood, we would. But he's the only one that has clean blood. Please, just sign the form." What would you do? In enough silence, you sign the form, because you know it's the only thing to you. And the doctor says to you, "Would you like a moment with your son before we get started?" Could you walk into that hospital room where your son sits at a table saying, "Daddy, Mommy, what's going on?" Could you tell your son you love him? When the doctors and nurses come back and say, "I'm sorry, we've got to get started now. People all over the world are dying." Could you leave? Could you walk out while your son is crying out to you, "Mom, Dad, what's going on? Where are we going? Why are you leaving? Why are you abandoning me?" The following week, they hold a ceremony to honor your son for his phenomenal contribution to humanity. But some people sleep through it. Others don't even bother to come because they have better things to do. And some people come with a pretentious smile and pretend to care. While others sit around and say, "This ceremony is boring. Wouldn't you want to stand up and say to all of them, 'Excuse me, I'm not sure if you're aware of it or not, but the amazing life you have, my son did it. My son died so you could have this life. My son died so you could live. He died for you. Doesn't it mean anything to you?'" Perhaps that's what God wants to say. What does the death of God mean to you? What does the death of the Son of God, who had redeeming and precious blood, who gave everything, mean to you? In a world where people are consumed with fear, we are called to have no fear. And we know we have the body and blood of a son who can save us. May we never forget that. And as our world panics, may we remain calm. Calm in the arms of the Savior, calm in the arms of the God who loves us.
From there you come to judge the living and the dead. Pray, brothers and sisters, my sacrifice and yours, be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
May this sacrifice, Lord, be great, cleanse his heart from sin, sanctify your faith in the body and mind, for the celebration of the Paschal festivities through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free.
Therefore, our Lord, as we celebrate the glory of the sacred passion of your Son upon earth, resurrection, and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you thanksgiving this holy and this sacrament. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body of your Son and full of the Holy Spirit can become one body and spirit in Christ. May you make of us eternal offering to you, so we may obtain an inheritance. we rely on our failing help. And this sacrifice and our reconciliation, we pray for the Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. And please confirm the faith and charity of the Pilgrim Church of Earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Charles, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have made for your own. Listen graciously. The prayers of this family who have come before you. Your compassion, merciful Father, gather yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. For the part of brothers and sisters and you all who are pleased to hear the passing from this life, give kind of minister to you. They hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through and with him and to him. O God, Almighty Father, and the Holy Spirit,
Those of you who don't know, Father John Hollowell is
super excited about the priest that is coming here. It is his first year as a priest, which means it'll be his first third Sunday of Lent. I am his spiritual director, and this guy is so excited about being a priest, it will make me look bored. So he will be covering Mass for me while I am gone. And Father Sutherland will be here. I also, there has been announcements in the bulletin. The weekend that I get, the weekend following me being away is March 21st. So I would like to make a reminder that we are having a first time ever event, which is very much necessary in our world. It is, I'm calling it P3. But it is porn, pork, and pancakes. And the reality is that pornography is literally destroying marriages, destroying lives, and we have to talk about it. So it is a father-son event, or just fathers, or just sons, or just men. It is a men event. I apologize, lady. Pornography is an issue for women as well, but this is where we're starting, at least. Like, we gotta start somewhere, so this is where I'm starting. So, I would hope that many, many, many men, not because you have an issue with pornography, although some of you very possibly do, but all men, because the reality is if you have a son or a grandson, and we're not talking about this, if you haven't had the conversation, if you're not having the conversation, it's already too late. So please be attentive to those things.